الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه الطيبين الطاهرين. First of all, I would like to welcome you all to our weekly session, and we are honored to host Sheikh Hassan Abd al-Rahman, Imam of Masjid al-Nur in Flint. May Allah reward him for his efforts there and in the also the community of Flint. Our speaker today study under prominent scholars in Egypt and Yemen and in a variety of Islamic knowledge, fiqh, usul, and hadith. And at one time, he was the translator of Sheikh al-Azhar, mashallah. And he authored several books in fiqh and hadith in both languages, Arabic and language. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reward him for all his efforts. Our lecture is 45 minutes, inshallah, followed by 15 minutes of Q&A session, inshallah. I move to talk now to our Sheikh, Zahra Khair.
Jazakumullah khair. Jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah, alladhi hadana bi ahmadin dinan lahu tadana. Falam yazal yanma bihi al-islamu حتى استبانت للهدى أعلام مؤيدا منه بخير الكتب وحيا إليه بلسان عربي لكونه أشرف ما به نطق كما الرسول خير مخلوق خلق صلى عليه الله ثم سلم وآله وصحبه وكرما وبعد فالعلم جليل القدر وفي قليله مفاد العمر فابدأ بما هو الأهم فالأهم فالهازم البادئ فيما يستتب لأنه من يتقن بعض الفن يضطر للباقي ولا يستغني أما بعد إني لفرح مسرور أنه قد أوتيحت لي فرصة إلقاء على إخوتي وأخواتي الكرام. I'm very happy that the opportunity has been given to me to disseminate information to my honorable brothers and sisters. And as I mentioned, I'll mention part of what I said in the introduction, translate part of it, and it's the last part, which is, فَالْعِلْمُ جَلِيلُ الْقَدْرِ That knowledge has a lofty station, a lofty station. So much so, للدرجة أنه لا أحد ينكر إذا نسب إليه العلم وإن لم يكن من حامله. Right? Right? So knowledge has a lofty station to the point that no one would ever refuse to have it attributed to them even if they weren't from the carriers of knowledge. So this shows that knowledge is very lawful, very lofty rather. والعلم الشيء الوحيد في القرآن أمر الله تعالى نبيه صلى الله عليه وسلم من طلب الاستزادة منه. And knowledge is the only thing in the Quran that Allah Ta'ala ordered his prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم to seek more. فقل ربي زدني علما. So say, oh my Lord, increase me in knowledge. وأعلى أنواع العلم العلم بكتاب الله وسنة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. And the highest forms of knowledge is the knowledge of the book of Allah and the knowledge of the sunnah of the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. وقد أنزل الله تعالى القرآن على النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وبين هذا العلم الإلهي ليس بي شيء هين. And he made it clear that this knowledge that was sent down from the Lord of the world is not something light. إذ قال الله تعالى إنا سنلقي عليك قولا ثقيلا Because Allah Ta'ala said, indeed, we're going to send down upon you a heavy word. A heavy word. فَلَمَّا وَصَفَ اللَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى الْقُرْآنِ بِأَنَّهُ قَوْلًا ثَقِيلًا فَكُلُّ مَنْ يُرِيدُ أَنْ يَسْتَقْبَلْ تِلْكَ الْآيَاتِ فَلَا بُدْ أَنْ يُجَهِزْ نَفْسَهُ لِحَمْلَ ثَقِيلًا. Right? So whoever wants to receive these verses of the Qur'an, he must prepare himself to carry something heavy. كَمَا يُجَهِزْ إِنْسَانْ نَفْسَهُ إِذَا قِيلَ لَهُ أُرِيدُكَ أَنْ تُسَعِدْنِي فِي رَفْعِ هَذَا شَيْءٍ وَإِذَا كَانَ شَيْءٍ فَقِيلٍ فَأَنْشَمْ يُبْرَمْ الْأَكْمَامِ وَيُجَهِزْ ظَهْرَهُ يعني يتمدد. Just like if someone was to say, I want you to come help me lift this thing with something heavy. You will see he rolls up his sleeves and begins stretching, right? He said, this is heavy, so he has to prepare to lift this thing because it's heavy. فَلَمَّا قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى إِنَّا سَنُلْقِي عَلَيْكَ قَوْلًا ثَقِيلًا فَإِنسَانْ يُجَهِزْ قَلْبَهُ وَعَقْلُهُ وَجَوَارِحِ. So a person must prepare his heart, his mind, his limbs, لِحَمْلِي هَذَا الثُّقْرِ, in order to carry this weight, the weight of the Qur'an and the weight of the sunnah of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. وَقَدْ تَكَلَّمَ النَّبِيُّ صلى الله عليه وسلم بِالنَّفَائِسِ إِذْ أُوتِيَ جَوَامِ الْكَلِمِ. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم spoke words of that are like jewels, because he was given what? جَوَامِ الْكَلِمِ. جَوَامِ الْكَلِمِ, he was given eloquence. Not the eloquence in which ليس البلاغة المملة المستمدة من أي تشكل في الألفاظ وعبارات. He was given بلاغة, he was given جوامي الكلم, not that eloquent speech that comes from using different types of vocabulary and phrases and like that, that impresses the people. لا جوامي الكلم, الكلام القليل بالمعاني كثيرة. So he was given short speech with deep and many meanings. فمن ذلك الذي رواه الإمام مسلم. And from that is that which was collected by Imam Muslim, وحديث أبي تميم بن أوس الداري قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الدين النصيحة. الدين النصيحة. When he said that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said that the deen is نصيحة. نصيحة. Right? He said the religion is نصيحة. وفي اللغة يعتبر هذه الجملة جملة بدلية البدل. الدين النصيحة. And in the Arabic language, this, and I don't know a term in English grammar that would express it, this is called بدل. الدين النصيحة. بدل. And there's types of different types of بدل. Right? بدل شيء من الشيء. When you is to exchange something. Meaning, these, both of these words, even though one came before the other, they hold the same weight. In English, it's used when you replace a proper noun with a pronoun, for instance, right? Huwa Khalid, right? So huwa Khalid, you take the pronoun, he's Khalid, so he is Khalid. So he and Khalid have the same way because a pronoun replaces a proper noun. So ad-dinu nasiha, al-ithnan, ala nafs al-mustawa fil jumla. So both of these words on the same level in the sentence, right? نستطيع أن نقول بدل شيء من الشيء. You exchange one for another. You can say النصيحة هي الدين. You can say النصيحة is the religion. The religion is نصيحة, or نصيحة is the religion. This is بدل شيء من الشيء. قام زيد أخوك, right? Your brother Zaid stood, or أخوك قام أخوك زيد, or your brother Zaid stood, or Zaid your brother stood. Same, it's the same thing, right? الحرم المكي, right? المكي الحرم, أو مكة الحرم, right? The sanctity of Mecca, أو مكة is the sanctity, and like that. والله أعلى وأعلى. ففي هذا الحديث سبحان الله لما بين هذا النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان الصحابة حرساء على زيادة الاستفادة من أقوال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم للبيان. So when the Prophet said this to companions, they were very diligent They were very diligent in guarding any increase of benefit that they can receive from the statement of the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم. فقال قلنا. He didn't say قلت. لم يقل قلت. قال قلنا لمن. So he didn't say I said or I asked. He said we. لمن. We said oh, to who. وكلمة نصيحة لها عدة معاني. And the word نصيحة has many meanings. فمنها الإخلاص. ومنها الإرشاد. So from the meanings of النصيحة is sincerity. And from the meanings of النصيحة is to guide. To guide someone. الإهداء, when someone is wants to point someone in the correct direction. This is from النصيحة. This is from الوصايا. Right? This is from leaving someone with heavy and very important advice. This is loosely translated as advice. But النصيحة, it's deeper. أعمق من just simply saying advice. قلنا لمن. So we said, to who? To who is this النصيحة? Or to who is this, if we use بدل, الدين. الدين. To go back to the first point. نرجع إلى النقطة الأولى. وهو استواء الدين والنصيحة في هذه العبارة. سبحان الله. If we look, إذا نظرنا إلى هذه العبارة وأن الدين النصيحة ونصيحة الدين, that the religion is sincerity and sincere advice. And sincere advice and sincerity is from the deen. هذا يبين لنا جليا كيف نتعامل مع ربنا سبحانه وتعالى وكيف نتعامل مع بعضنا. This clearly explains to us how we deal with our Lord سبحانه وتعالى بالنصح, and how we deal with one another. فغاية النصيحة هو الرغبة الخالصة أو الإرادة الخالصة أو القصد الصريح. It means a pure desire or a true determination or a true intention. لما يصلح المنسوح. لما يصلح المنسوح. So it's for that which will rectify the one that's receiving it. This is what it's about. الدين النصيحة. لمن؟ قلنا لمن؟ We said, to who? قال لله. قال لله. فبدأ بالله سبحانه وتعالى. So he said, for Allah. So it began with our Lord سبحانه وتعالى. فإذا فهمنا كلمة نصيحة بمعنى بالإنجليزية advice, لا يستقيم. لا يستقيم المعنى, صح؟ We look at the word nasiha, that it means advice, and then he said to Allah, then the meaning doesn't fit, doesn't work. How do you advise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Impossible. عالم الغيب والشهادة. How can you give advice to the one who knows the seen and the unseen? فإذن نفهم من ذلك أن النصيحة في هذا الموقف لله بمعنى الإخلاص. بمعنى الإخلاص. That nasiha in this point, in this particular situation, it means sincerity. It means sincerity. It doesn't mean advice. It means sincerity. لله. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what it means. كما قال الله تعالى في سورة التحريم. التحريم قال يا أيها الذين آمنوا توبوا إلى الله توبة نصوحا. Same word. So Allah Ta'ala said, oh, you believe, repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a sincere repentance. فلما ننظر إلى الإخلاص, الآن نحن في دفعة من هذا القرن أن كثير من الناس يهتمون بالصحة.
right? We're living in a period of this century in which many people are really worried about health.
فمن اهتمامهم للصحة يريدون الطعام والشراب النقي. ها؟ خالص من شوائب من الأضرار من أي شيء من ذلك القبيل, right?
So people, when they want food, they want the food that's pure, clean, and that's free from pollution and free from anything that causes harm. This is what the people want when they want to be healthy, right?
فالإيمان, الإيمان لابد من ذلك.
So إيمان has to be like that, خالي من الشوائب,
خالي عن ما يخالف الإخلاص لله سبحانه وتعالى.
It has to be free of pollution and free of that which what? Which opposes being sincere to Allah تعالى. لا إكره في الدين. Allah said, well, there's no compulsion in religion. قد تبين الرشد من الغي.
That الرشد, proper guidance has been made clear from going astray.
فمن يكفر بالطاغوت ويؤمن بالله.
So he said, فمن يكفر فقدم الكفر على الإيمان.
So Allah تعالى had كفر بالطاغوت
مقدم على الإيمان بالله.
Allah تعالى put disbelieving in طاغوت. والطاغوت كل ما يعبد من دون الله. And the طاغوت is everything that is worshipped besides Allah سبحانه وتعالى.
فمن يكفر بالطاغوت هذا شرط لابد يكون مقدما ومقدما.
It has to be first, it has to proceed. فمن يكفر بالطاغوت ويؤمن بالله فقد استمسك بالعروة الوثقى.
So whoever disbelieves in الطاغوت and then believes in Allah سبحانه وتعالى. فكل من يريد أن يكون مسلما خالصا لله سبحانه وتعالى لابد أن يسبق ذلك الإيمان بالكفر.
No, it sounds strange, right? هذا عجيب هذا القول, right? So whoever wants to be a sincere Muslim submitting to Allah سبحانه وتعالى first, before he can be a believer, before he can have iman, he has to what? Have pure kufr first. Pure.
ماذا كيف يكون كفر خالص للمسلم؟ بمعنى لابد أن يكفر كفرا تاما بكل ما يعبد من دون الله.
So the person must disbelieve a total pure disbelief in everything that is worshipped besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
شرط. شرط. فإذا بقي في قلبه شوائب الأوثان والأصنام والنجوم وكل ما يعبد من دون الله سبحانه وتعالى ذلك يقلل من إخلاصه وإيمانه بالله سبحانه وتعالى.
So every time that his faith is polluted with believing and statues and idols and anything that is worshipped besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then this now affects the purity of his faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
قلنا لمن؟
Said to who?
قال لله. لله. وإخلاص لله هو بأن نريده في عباداتنا ولا نريد غيره معه.
And the meaning of ikhlas lillah, sincerity to Allah, is that we only want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through our acts of worship, and we don't want anyone else along with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
وَلَا نَبْتَغِي غَيْرَهُ, nor do we seek other than him, subhanahu wa ta'ala, lillah. وَأَوَّلْ شَيْءٍ فِي النَّصِيحَ لِلَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى هُوَ إِيمَان الْجَازِمْ. إيمان الجازم به سبحانه وتعالى.
That it has to be a firm faith in him سبحانه وتعالى.
لا شك في ذلك الإيمان.
Cannot be any doubt.
يقول الله تعالى في مطلع البقرة ذلك الكتاب.
الله تعالى says in the beginning of سورة البقرة ذلك الكتاب. لا ريب فيه. وعند علم الوقف والابتداء, In the science of stopping and beginning in the recitation of Quran, يقرأ العلماء ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين. So they stop on ريب. So they read it, they say that this is the book. No doubt. guidance to the people of Taqwa. وفي عفوا يا أستاذ. لا هذا أسلوب النقل ذلك الكتاب ولكن لبعدهم عن الكتاب ولقربه هذا بمعنى هذا فذلك جاء بمعنى هذا في هذه الآية إن شاء الله وانظر في التفسير إن شاء الله فإذن ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه ذلك الكتاب this Quran لا ريب so we stop and say لا ريب وفي القراءة ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه فإذا وقفنا على الريب في الأول we stop at doubt this is the book no doubt فمعناه أو معنى الآية أن لا شك أن هذا القرآن الذي بين يدينا اليوم هو نفس القرآن المنزل على محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم هو ليس كما يزعم بعض الناس أن لا العبارات حكاية النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عن قوله تعالى that oh no the Quran we have today is an expression of the Prophet of what Allah Ta'ala revealed. حاشا لله. No, this is not the situation. وإذا قرأنا بالقراءة الأخرى ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه it means that this is the Quran, there's no doubt in it. So we have two removals of doubt. أول شيء لا شك أن القرآن الذي عندنا بين الدفتين هو القرآن المنزل على النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. So the first doubt that was removed, that this Quran that we have between these two covers, that it is the same Quran that was sent down upon the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه. Also within the verses of the Quran, there's no doubt in those verses in the Quran. So there's no doubt that this is the Quran that we have, and there's no doubt in the Quran itself. سبحانه. فإذن الإخلاص لله الإيمان بالله الجازم بالله سبحانه وتعالى. وحده لا شريك له ومن إظهار ذلك الإيمان امتثال أوامره في القرآن واجتناب نواهيه and the way that this iman is expressed is by following his commands and staying away from his prohibitions this is how we show that we believe in Allah سبحانه وتعالى إذا أمرنا بشيء فعلناه على قدر الاستطاعة. So if Allah ordered us with something, we do it based on our ability. وإذا نهانا عن شيء اجتنبناه. And if He prohibited us from something, we stayed away from it. هذا هو إخلاص لله سبحانه وتعالى. قلبا وقالبا. In our heart, in our hearts and in our actions. In our hearts and in our actions. هو إخلاص لله سبحانه وتعالى. ومن إخلاص لله سبحانه وتعالى هو تصديق كل ما أخبرنا به على لسان نبيه صلى الله عليه وسلم. And also from sincerity to Allah is that we believe in everything that He informed us about upon the tongue of the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم سواء أكان ذلك في القرآن أو صح عنه في سنته عليه الصلاة والسلام. And it doesn't matter if that information is mentioned in the Quran or authentically reported from the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم لله. قلنا لمن قال لله. We said to who? He said to Allah سبحانه وتعالى. ولكتابه. ولكتابه. Also الإخلاص لكتاب الله سبحانه وتعالى. فعلى رأس الإخلاص لكتاب الله سبحانه وتعالى هو تصديق بأن القرآن كلام الله المنزل. So at the top of having sincerity to the Quran, the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is to believe that it is the speech of Allah that was sent down. Subhanahu. وكل ما أخبر به ربنا سبحانه وتعالى من الأمم السابقة. In everything that Allah Ta'ala explained to us and revealed to us concerning the nations that passed away. وكل ما أمرنا به في القرآن نصدق ولا نتعارض أمرا ولا نهيا بما يستجد اليوم. And we do not oppose a command or a prohibition through new things that come about today. لكتابه فإيمان بأنه هو منزل من الله وهو كلام الله سبحانه وتعالى. And it is the speech of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. منزل على قلب محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. قل من كان عدو لجبريل فإنه نزله على قلبك بإذن الله. Say whoever is an enemy to Jibreel, for indeed he has brought this Quran down to you upon your heart by the permission of Allah. مصدقا لما بين يديه. Confirming that which came before it. وهدى وبشرى للمؤمنين. And a guidance and a glad tidings to those who believe. This is the Quran. لا ريب فيه. لا ريب فيه. فإخلاص لكتاب الله سبحانه وتعالى الإيمان جازم بالقرآن أنه كلام الله منزل على قلب محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم بحروفه ومعانيه. That it is the speech of Allah sent down on the heart of the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم in its letters and in its meanings. In its letters, ألف لام ميم صاد قاف وما إلى ذلك. All of that is sent down on the heart of the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. وبالإيمان بالقرآن كما ذكرنا في إيمان بالله. And part of having faith in the Quran, just like we mentioned, having faith in Allah سبحانه وتعالى, امتثال الأوامر في القرآن, to follow the commands in the Quran, واجتناب النواهي في القرآن, and to stay away from that which was prohibited in the Quran, كما جاء في حديث سهل بن سعد الساعدي قال لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يا رسول الله أرأيت إذا صليت المكتوبات وصمت رمضان وأحللت حلال وحرمت الحرام أدخل الجنة؟ قال نعم. Like in that hadith when he said to the Prophet يا رسول الله, do you see if I prayed the five prayers and I fasted Ramadan and I treated the halal as halal and the haram as haram, will I go to Jannah? قال نعم. Prophet said نعم. قال الإمام النووي رحمه الله تعالى ومعنى أحللت الحلال أفوا حرمت الحرام اجتنبته. He said in the meaning that I took the haram as haram, it means I stayed away from it. فلابد أن ننظر في ثيابنا. We have to look at ourselves at this point. He said ومعنى حرمت الحرام, he said in the meaning of حرمت الحرام اجتنبته, that I stayed away from it. فهل نحن, وأنا أسأل نفسي وكل واحد يسأل نفسه, I ask myself and everybody asks your own self, هل نحن نحرم الحرام بهذا المعنى؟ Do we treat the haram as haram with this meaning? He said, وَمَعْنَا حَرَمْتُ الْحَرَمْ اجْتَنَبْتُ. In meaning that I will treat the haram as haram, that I will stay away from it. Do we deal with the haram that way? Asking me, you ask yourself, وَمَعْنَا حَرَمْتُ الْحَرَمْ اجْتَنَبْتُهُ. In the meaning of that, I treated the haram as haram, that I stayed away from it. لا إله إلا الله. وراءنا عمل. We have work behind us. We have work and we're really in front of us with this meaning. ومعنى أحللت الحلال فألته متقدا حله. In the meaning of treating the halal as halal, that I did it, believing it's permissible. ونحن خاصة بعد وصولنا إلى هذه البلاد وبلاد الأوروبية الأخرى نستحي من الحلال إذا كانت تخالف المجتمع, right? And we, after arriving at these European lands, we are shy of things that are halal. We're shy. Things in the religion that are halal. بل بعض الأشياء مستحبة. Some things are highly recommended. شأن نستحي. We're shy to perform them because it goes against what is known in the societies we live in. ومعنى الحلال الحلال فعلته معتقدا حلو. That I do it believing it to be halal. That I do it believing to be halal. فلا بد للأمة, للأمة الإسلامية من شخصية, من ما اسمه, كلمة ذهبت عني. The Muslim ummah needs to have a personality. They have to have a personality.
لا نكون نعم شخصية أو الكلمة أخرى أيضا أكون شخصية، لا أريد كلمة هوية، هوية yeah, نعم لا لابد أن نكون لنا هوية. We have to have an identity. الأمم كلها مهما كانت الاعتقاد عندها والعادات والتقاليد يعني تبرز ما عندها. The other nations, all of them, no matter what they're upon from their belief, from their behavior, from their cultural practices, they put it out there. ولو خالف الفطرة تماماً 100% لا يبالون، يقول نحن على هذا اليوم. وحتى لو انكرنا عليهم يقول بالأمس أنتم انكرتم على هذا، قالوا لا واليوم نحن على هذا، تغيروا. The other nations, they are proud. They do what they do, even if it opposes the nature of the human being. Even if we tell them, you didn't used to be like that before. You used to say the same thing we're saying. They say, okay, it doesn't matter. We've changed. We're doing this now. Proud. فلابد أن تكون لنا هوية. So we have to have an identity. أحبونا أو كرهونا. It doesn't matter if they loved us or hated us. لكن يعرفون المسلمون معرفون بكذا وكذا وكذا. That the Muslims are known for this and this and that. لله ولكتابه. وقال ولرسوله. And to the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم. سبحان الله. أسأل الله أن يغفر لنا. خذلناه صلى الله عليه وسلم. We ask Allah تعالى to forgive us. We have abandoned the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم في النصيحة له. We have abandoned the Prophet in being sincere to him. عليه الصلاة والسلام. لأننا لو فعلا أحببنا ما تركنا شيء شيئا أمر به وما دخلنا في شيء نهى عنه. Because if we really loved him, we would not have left off anything he ordered with, nor would we went into that which he had prohibited. وفي قول جميل جدا قال أحد الدعاء اليوم يعني أنا من مصر من الإسكندرية. One of the callers is a beautiful statement, a funny statement that he said. A caller, a da'i from Alexandria, Egypt. He said, الفرق بيننا وبين الصحابة. الفرق بيننا وبين الصحابة. أنهم إذا علموا أنه جاء فعل ثابت عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فعلوه. فإذا سئلوا لما فعلتموه قالوا لأنه السنة. Right? He said, look at the difference between us and the companions. They, the companions, if they heard about something authentically reported from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he did it, they would do it. And if they were asked, why did you do that? They would say, because it's the sunnah. وأما نحن فإذا علمنا أنه شيء ثابت عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم غير جزم أو التزام أو إلزام عفوا تركناه. وإذا سئلنا لماذا تركتموه قلنا لأنه سنة. سبحان الله. Look at the difference in the way of thinking. So if something authentically reached us from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, right? And we knew that it was authentic, but it wasn't an obligation. We'd abandon it. And then when we're asked, why didn't you do it? We say, oh, because of sunnah. So they do it. من غير إلزام. The Sahaba did it. بغير إلزام, without it being an obligation, لأنه sunnah, because it's from the sunnah. And we abandoned it because it's not an obligation, because it's sunnah. ولذلك بشروا هؤلاء الرجال بالجنة وهم يمشون على وجه الأرض. And for that reason, those men were given the glad tidings of Jannah while they were walking on the face of the earth. ونحن سنظل. أسأل الله أن يغفر لنا. آمين. سنظل في شك من ذلك بين الخوف والرجاء. سبحان. But we will remain in doubt about that. Entering Jannah between fear and hope. فنرجو للمسيء عفوا للمحسن عفوا ونخاف على المسيء. So we have hope for the one that does good and we fear for the one that does evil. قال الله تعالى في سورة النساء
قل أمرا أمرا للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. Said, say, ordering the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, إن كنتم تحبون الله فاتبعوني. Say, if you love Allah, follow me. فنسأل أنفسنا, we ask ourselves, we ask ourselves, إذا حضرنا النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم اليوم, هل سيعرفنا؟ If the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was present amongst us today, would he know us? يعني كرجال من أمته, as men from his nation. You know about the hadith, نعلم أن حديث الحوض, the hadith of the pond. يعرض عليه الناس يوم القيامة فيقول أمتي أمتي فيضرب بينه وبينهم صور. People will be presented to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he will say, "My ummah, my nation, my nation." And then it will be stricken a wall up between him and them. وَيُقَالُ لَهُ لَا تَعْلَمُ لَا تَعْلَمُ مَا غَيَّرُوا مِنْ بَعْدِكَ. It will be said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "You don't know what they changed after you. You don't know what they changed after you." فَيَقُولُ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ سُحْكًا سُحْكًا لِمَنْ غَيَّرَ بَعْدِي. It'll get away those who changed after me. ولرسوله النصيحة لرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم. So, sincerity to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. تعصي الحبيب وأنت تزعم حبه. Huh? You disobey your beloved while claiming you love him. Right? إلى آخر القول. To the end of the statement. Claiming love. فكما جاء في حديث ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لو يقطع الناس بدعواهم لإدعى الناس دماءكم وأموالهم ولكن البينة على المدعي. If people were to be given according to what they claim, they would claim the blood and property of other people. But what the burden of proof is on the one who makes the claim. أحب النبي ما دليلك؟ ليس لغيرك لنفسك. انظر في المرآة. Not for other than you, for yourself. Look in the mirror. قل لنفسك أنا أحب النبي. Say to yourself, I love the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. ثم انظر في أحوالك من قرب أو بعد عن ما كان عليه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. And then look into your situation, whether it's close or far from what the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is upon. هذه الموازين والمقاييس. These are the scales and the measuring sticks. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. ليس ما يرضي الناس وليس ما يفرح الناس. Not what pleases the people and makes the people happy. هو صلى الله عليه وسلم. وكذلك جعلناكم أمة وسط. أين وقعت هذه الآية؟ أسأل الإخوة. هذه آية وقعت يعني هي من يعني أعجائب القرآن. أين وقعت هذه الآية؟ Where did this ayah fall in? Where did this ayah fall? And like that, we made you a middle course nation. Where's this ayah? Anyway. وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا. In Surah Al-Baqarah. لكن وين؟ أين بالضبط؟ Where precisely in Surah Al-Baqarah? Sheikh Sa'ad. وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا. Right. And then Allah said, and like this, we made you a middle course nation. In this ayah is right in the middle of Surah Al-Baqarah. سورة البقرة 286 آية. سورة البقرة 286 آية. في آية 143 هذه الآية. The 143 right in the middle is this آية. جعلناكم أمة وسطا. لتكونوا so that you will be شهداء على الناس. Witnesses over the people ويكون الرسول عليكم شهيدا. And the prophet a witness over you. فكيف إذا جئنا من كل أمة بشهيد وجئنا بك على هؤلاء شهيدا. So how will it be when we will bring a witness from every nation and bring you O Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم as a witness over these people. لا إله إلا الله. يوم صعب. Difficult day. لما يشهد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم على أمته هل كانوا على ما كان عليه. When the Prophet is brought as a witness over his ummah, were they upon what he was upon? ولأئمة المسلمين وعماتهم. And for the leaders of the believers and their general folk. So الآن في هذا الجزء من الحديث النصيحة بمعنى الإرشاد. In this part of the hadith, now nasiha means what? Guidance, advice, and like that. ومن الصرف العربية, from صرف the morphation of verbs in عربية, عندنا أسماء تستنبط أو تستخرج من المصادر. So we have nouns that are taken from the root of the word. فمن النصيحة المنصحة, المنصحة. والمنصحة اجتماع الخيط والإبر. ها؟ المنصحة. So منصحة from the word نصيحة, you get the, this is when the thread in the needle comes together. فإذا هناك فرق شاسع بين النصيحة والتعيير. Huh? Then there's a big difference between giving someone advice and exposing them, humiliating them, reminding them of their mistakes or some error that you believe they would have. ليس بالنصيحة. النصيحة تصلح ولا تفسد. نصيحة, it rectifies and it doesn't cause corruption. الدين نصيحة ولأئمة المسلمين وعماتهم. فنحن كأمة لابد أن ننظر بعضنا لبعض, ولا عبرة في من يغضب. So no consideration should be given to the one who becomes angry because he's advised. لا, العبرة في أن نقول الحق ولا نخاف في الله لومة لائم. The important thing that be taken into consideration is that we tell the truth and we do not fear the blame of the blamers. نقول الحق ولو مر. We say the truth even if it's bitter. ولو على نفسك. And even if it's against ourselves. يا أيها الذين آمنوا كونوا قوامين بالقسط شهداء لله. Or you believe, be standards of justice, witnesses for Allah. ولو على أنفسكم أو الوالدين أو الأقربين. Even if it is against yourself or your parents or your relatives. أن يكون غنيا أو فقيرا فالله أولى بهما. Even if they're rich or poor, Allah has more right to them. فَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا الْهَوَاءَ. So do not follow your desires and تَعْدِلُوا from being justice, from being just. فَقُلُّ مَا يُصْلِحْ المسلم كشخص والأمة لابد أن نقول بها إذا علمناه. So everything that rectifies a Muslim as an individual or the ummah in its entirety, we have to say it. وَالْعَصْرِ. Huh? Allah swore by the time. الدهر. The time. والعصر. إن الإنسان لا في خسر. By the time, indeed, mankind, جنس الإنس, this the race of mankind, the human race, in loss. Hello? In loss. In loss. إلا الذين آمنوا. Except for those who believe. This is the first. هذا أول استثناء. This is the first exception. Except for those who believe. فالإيمان لكي إنسان يخرج من الخسران, أول شيء لابد أن يكون له إيمان. So in order for a person to get out of being in loss, to being destroyed, the first thing he has to have إيمان. Has to have إيمان. فلا نجاة ولا فوز ولا فلاح لمن لا إيمان له. So there is no success, there is no victory for the one who doesn't have iman. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. First, شرط الأول. That's the first condition in order not to be destroyed in this loss. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Wow. وَهَذَا لَيْسَ الْفَوْزَ الْكَامِلُ. This is not complete victory, complete success. لماذا؟ لابد من دليل على الإيمان. Why? Because there must be proof that the iman is there. وهذا الدليل لابد أن يظهر على الجوارح. And this evidence must be apparent upon the limbs. إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات. And did righteous deeds. بلى. Allah said بلى. من أسلم وجهه لله. Allah said nay. On the contrary, whoever submitted himself to Allah وهو محسن. He didn't leave it as just submitting to Allah. بل اشترط أن يكون محسنا. He has to also be a doer of good. فله أجره عند ربه. So this one's the one that has his reward with his Lord. ولا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون. And they will have no fear upon them nor will they grieve. إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات. Except for those who believed and did righteous deeds. فالإيمان فقط لا يكفي. هذا مدعى فقط. So faith alone is not sufficient. This is just a claim. ما دليل؟ What's the proof of your إيمان؟ الأعمال الصالحة. والأعمال لا تكون صالحة إلا إذا ثبتت عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، إما في القرآن، نص القرآن، أو على لسان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. And actions are not righteous. Actions are not righteous unless they are authentically reported that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. نريد بهذا الأعمال، نريد بها ثواب الله. We're talking about the actions in which we want from it the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the actions cannot be righteous unless they come from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, either from a text in the Quran or from an authentic narration that the Prophet said this is a righteous deed. فكل ما يسعى فيه الإنسان ليتقرب إلى الله سبحانه وتعالى إذا ما لديه كتاب ناطق أو سنة متبعة فهو على طلال. فهو على الضلال. So whoever did an action and he doesn't have an evidence from the action, from the book, the Quran, or a sunnah that is followed from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, then he's upon misguidance. قل إن كنتم تحبون الله فاتبعوني. So if you love Allah, follow me. This is what Allah Ta'ala told the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم to say to us as an ummah. وتواصوا النصيحة. بالحق بالحق. So in order to get away from being in loss and destruction, we have to advise one another with truth. With truth. وليس كل شخص يرتاح للحق. Everybody is not comfortable with the truth. Everyone's not comfortable with the truth. ولكن الحق أحق أن يتبع. But the truth has more right to be followed. The truth has more right to be followed. فانزعج في الدنيا حتى ترتاح في الآخرة. So be irritated and bothered in the dunya من كلمة الحق التي هي تأتي على الجرح أحيانا. From the statement of the truth that sometimes it hurts. It's like it strikes that wound. It's like pouring salt in the wound. It makes you uncomfortable sometimes. أحيانا تزعجك كلمة الحق تزعجك تخرجنا من الارتياح في هوائنا because the statement of the truth it stops us from being able to be comfortable on our desires. Can't be comfortable in our desires when the truth is told. Oh, now I can't say that, I can't do that. Nah. ولكن هذا الذي ينجيك يوم القيامة. This is what will save you يوم القيامة. فتنزعج قليلا هذه فترة يسيرة جدا. So be uncomfortable, be irritated a little bit so that you can be what? Relax يوم القيامة. والتواصل بالصبر. And also we have to advise each other with patience. أي صبر هذا؟ What patience is this? ثلاثة. ثلاثة. أنواع الصبر ثلاثة. So what patience is this? The types of صبر, patience is three. الصبر الأول صبر على طاعة الله. The first type of patience being patient upon the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Patience. لأن امتثال الأوامر تحتاج قوة إيمانية تدفع الإنسان إلى فعل ما أمر الله سبحانه وتعالى. So the first type is patience upon obedience of Allah because it takes the strength of faith to push an individual to do what Allah Ta'ala has commanded. وهو حر أن يمتثل أو يعصي. Because he's free to do it or to disobey Allah سبحانه وتعالى. لم نبتلى بشيء أشد علينا من هذه الحرية. We have not been tested. We have not been tested about anything that is more heavy upon us than this freedom that we have. والله. وكل يريد كل يريد أن أريد خيارات أريد أمامي يعني خيارات يعني ليس شيء واحد. We say that we I want choices. You know, I don't want to have to be stuck to one thing. لكن تلك الخيارات التي أوقعنا فيما نحن فيه من معاصي الله. But these choices and options is what has made us fall into the disobedience of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. يا ليتنا ها اتبعنا الجبال. نعم إن شاء الله. أختم بهذا. As only we follow the mountains, the samawat. If only we follow the mountains and samawat. If abow had the hurriya because they refused to have the freedom of choice. فأختم بهذا. I'll stop at this point. أتواصل الصبر ثلاثة أنواع الصبر. Three types of صبر. صبر على طاعة الله حتى نؤدي أوامره. So we have to be patient upon obedience of Allah until we fulfill His commands. والصبر عن معاصيه. We have to be patient to stay away from His disobedience حتى لا نقع فيه. So that we don't fall in His disobedience. Have to be patient. لأن الدافع الشهوة. القاهرة. Because the thing that's pushing us to it is like a strong, compelling desire. فلا بد أن ندفع. So we have to repel it. We have to push it back so that we don't disobey Allah. والصبر الثالث. And the third type of sabr is as-sabr ala aqdar Allah al-mu'limah. The aqdar Allah al-mu'limah. And to be patient upon the painful decrees of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وهذا أردت أن أبدي لكم وهذا ما عندي. أسأل الله أن يتقبل منا جميعا صالح أعمالنا ويغفر لنا الزلات والمعاصي. والذنوب. And I ask Allah Ta'ala to accept from us our righteous actions and to forgive us from our slip-ups and our disobedience and our sins. هذا وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم.
جزاك الله خير. We thank our Sheikh Hassan. ما شاء الله. البليغ الفصيح.
الله يحفظكم.
And I forgot to mention earlier that he's memorizing, mashallah, several mutuns in فقه أصول حديث العقيدة. And you may notice that from his introduction, mashallah.
الله يبارك فيك. جزاك الله.
I open the floor now for question, inshallah. So I start from the right here. If any brothers has any question for our speaker, for our lecturer, inshallah. Any question?
To make da'wah lillah and also to make da'wah whatever from what you hear from Rasulullah
sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
So that's been a nasiha lillahi wa rasulihi.
Masha'Allah.
Of course, the Indian is still to have to be the Muhammadiyya. Khassati Muhammadiyya. Al-Tahmad al-Hadith, right?
أي نعم بارك الله فيك. نعم الشيخ حفظه الله تعالى هو يقصد الحديث الذي في المسند للإمام أحمد إذ قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم نظر له وجه امرئا سمع مقالتي فوعيها فأداها كما سمعها فرب حامل الفقه ليس بفقه ورب حامل الفقه يحمله إلى من؟ هو أفقه منه. So he's talking about the hadith that's in the Musnad and others in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said نَضَّرَ لَوْ وَجَمْرِئًا. May Allah put the nudra, the brightness, the light in the face of the individual. سَمِعَ مَقَالَتِي. That he hears a statement from me. مِنْ نَفَائِزْ هَذَا الْحَدِيثِ. From the jewels of this hadith. أَنَّهُ دليل على أن فترة عدم الكتابة والرواية أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان في أول الوهلة في نزول القرآن فقط ليس بعد ذلك. This hadith proves that the prohibition of writing down and memorizing and narrating what the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said was only for a short period of time when the Quran was first being revealed, and then that period came to an end. Why? Because people would narrate the hadith, and this is why, just like in the Quran, we have an-nasikh wa mansukh. In the Quran, we have the abrogated and abrogating verses. Likewise, in the Sunnah, we have an-nasikh wa mansukh. We have the abrogated and abrogating ahadith. So the hadith, when the Prophet mana'a al-kitaba anhu nusikha bi hadha al-hadith wa ahadith kamithlih. So the prohibition of the Prophet, when he prohibited people to write what he said or memorize what he said, anything except from the Quran, that was abrogated by this hadith and the other hadith that are just like it. Because how could there be a reward in doing something that he prohibited? Nadhara Allah, which he said, Allah, may Allah give the nadhara to the face of the one who memorizes his statement. And he hears it, and then he memorizes it as he heard it. And then he relates it exactly as he memorizes. He said, because maybe the one who carries the fiqh, it's not a faqih. And this is proof that a hadith is fiqh. He said, فَرُبَّحُ وَقَلُ أَنَّ مَقَالَتِهِ حَمِلِ الْفِقْ. So he said about the one who carries his statement is a person who carries fiqh. So it proves that the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ is fiqh. He said, لَيْسَ بِفَقِهِ وَرُبَّ حَمِلِ الْفِقْ. So referring to the hadith. And maybe the carrier of fiqh, he carries it to one who is what? More knowledgeable than him. Which points to another beautiful jewel that comes from this hadith, is that أحياناً يكون العالم قد حافظ. Sometimes a scholar could maybe not be someone who memorized the information, لكن يفقه, but he understands. فالحافظ غير فقه. So the one who memorized but doesn't understand, he takes that information to one who understands but didn't memorize. So you have two sides. You have one who memorized but he didn't understand, right? Right. And I'll give an example outside of what? Outside of religious knowledge for this, that we practice this in our daily lives, right? Al-ibn yati li-abihi. Yas'aluhu al-umur mustahdatha fi dunya, right? A son comes to his father and he asks him about some new things that are taking place in the dunya. So after he tells the father the details of it, the father either tells him, la, ya bunay, ibtad an hadha. And the children, the father, they think that the father doesn't understand. But the father knows what those things would lead to. So the child, he's what? He's inexperienced. He's inexperienced, so he believes, no, you're not understanding that. No, this is, he begins describing the father understands the tajrubati wa khibrati fil hayat. La, ibtad anhu ya bunay. He says no, because he has experience in life. He says, no, my son, stay away from it. Stay away from it. بخبرتي من من هو ليس من أهل العلم في هذا الشأن لكن هو من أهل العلم في الحياة والتجربة. Even though he's not from the people of knowledge in the affair that his son is asking about, but he's from the people of knowledge when it comes to life experience. So he can tell his son without having the experience that his son's had and having that issue, that issue should not be done or should be done. But likewise, what? The scholars of Islam, the person may come and say, yeah, Sheikh, I read a hadith, this is such and such. I never heard this hadith. But if it's authentic, then it means ABC. رُبَ حَمِلِ الْفِقْ لِيسَ بِفَقْهِ. نعم, فَلَسْتَ حَدِيثَ أَيْبَ سِفَعَكَ.
جزاك الله خير. أمين. إن شاء الله. I'll move question to the shalom. Yes, back to Barat. Okay.
جزاك الله خير.
أمين وإياكم. الله يحفظكم.
And directly, not related to what you said, but you said هُدَى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. I wonder if you can comment on, in the Quran, sometimes he says هُدَى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ, sometimes in النَّمَلْ هُدَى وَرَحْمَةً لِلْمُحْسِنِينَ, then هُدَى وَبُشْرَى. So I wonder if you can make a comment about the difference between هُدَى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ, هُدَى وَبُشْرَى, هُدَى وَرَحْمَةً.
ما شاء الله. نعم نعم, جزاك الله خير. سبحان الله, هذا سؤال جميل جدا. This is a beautiful question. This is a beautiful question. لأن هذا من تدبر القرآن, من تدبر القرآن. This is from pondering over the Quran, right? وكل المسؤول عن التدبر. لأن الله تعالى أنكر على من لا يتدبر, right? Everybody, يعني is responsible to ponder over the Quran because Allah تعالى may blameworthy the one who doesn't ponder over the Quran. In Surah An-Nisa, قال الله تعالى ماذا؟ أفلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا. Allah said, what? Do they not ponder over the Quran? If it was from other than Allah, they would find in it much schism. And in Surah Muhammad, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَى قُلُوبٍ أَقَفَالُهَا. Do they not ponder over the Quran, or do they have locks on their hearts? So Allah made تشبه بين الذي لا يتدبر القرآن بالذي له قف على قلبه. So he made the analogy between the one who doesn't ponder the Quran like one who has a lock on his heart. فمن تدبر القرآن قوله تعالى ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين للمحسنين هدى وبشرى للمؤمنين. That is هدى, is guidance. فلا شك أن القرآن كله هدى. أن القرآن كله هدى. So there's no doubt that the Quran, all of it is guidance. All of it is guidance. لكن ليس بهدى لغير من اتصف بمن استحق الهداية. But it is not guidance for those who does not have fit the descriptions and characteristics of those who deserve to be guided. لا إله إلا الله. فالله تعالى قال هدى للمتقين. فربط الهداية بالتقوى. So الله تعالى tied between what? Guidance and تقوى. فكل ما استزاد التقوى استزاد الهداية. استزادت الهداية. So every time the تقوى increases, the guidance from the Quran increases for that individual. وكلما نقص نقص الهداية. And every time the taqwa decreases, then the guidance through the Quran is decreased. على حسب. Right? Commensurate to that. كذلك الإحسان. Likewise, إحسان. Being excellent. Doing excellent good deeds. كلما زاد الإنسان إحسان لله سبحانه وتعالى. كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في حديث المتفق عليه. مشهور بحديث جبريل. Right, just like the Prophet said in the hadith that's agreed upon by Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim, that's famous as known as the hadith of Jibreel. لما سأله عليه السلام سأله صلى الله عليه وسلم أخبرني عن الإحسان. When he asked him, Jibreel عليه السلام asked the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, tell me, what is إحسان? It's excellence. What is إحسان? It's just like the doctor's asking. So what is هدى للمحسنين? قال الإحسان أن تعبد الله كأنك تراه. إحسان is that you worship Allah as though you can see him. وَأَنْ لَمْ تَكُنْ تَرَهْ فَإِنَّهُ يَرَهْ. And even though you cannot see him, you know that he sees you. هذا من مراقبة الله سبحانه وتعالى في العبادات في الحركات وسكنات. So this is from being aware of Allah سبحانه وتعالى أنه مطلع علينا. That he is seeing us in everything that we do, whether we're sitting still or moving. فكل ما زاد الإنسان إحسانا وتقوى زاد الهداية في القرآن. So every time a person increased in that, then the guidance in the Quran increases for him or her. وكل ما نقص في ذلك فينقص بذلك الهداية في القرآن لهذا الشخص. ونذير ذلك وهذا جميل جدا لأن القرآن مملوء بأشباه والنظائر. Right? And there's a polar opposite to that. Right? Because the Quran is filled with resembling analogies and with polar opposites. And this is from هذا من أجمل أنواع التدبر. الإنسان يبحث عن الأشباه والنظائر في القرآن. This is from the most beautiful ways of pondering of the Quran that we analyze the resembling verses and we analyze the polar opposites. Now Allah says إن الذين آمنوا. When Allah says إن الذين كفروا, we just step back and just take each time we take it and say, well, look at this. When Allah said, indeed those who believe, and then he follows it up with this. And then he said, indeed those who disbelieve, he follows this up with something else. And we see the polar opposites. لما وصف حالهم في الأخرى فعذاب وبوس وهذه الأشياء. When he describes the disbelievers, their situation in the hereafter, then it's punishment and like that. And then he describes the believers, then it's reward and joy and like that. فمن نظار هذه الآية في سورة البقرة نفسها إن الله لا يستحي أن يضرب مثلا ما بعوضة فما فوقها فأما الذين آمنوا فيعلمون أنه الحق من ربهم وأما الذين كفروا فيقولون ماذا أراد الله بهذا مثلا. Right? Allah تعالى said, indeed Allah is not shy to give thee an example of a gnat or that which is above it. As for those who believe, then they know it is the truth from their Lord. As for those who disbelieve, they say, what is Allah intending by this analogy? Allah said about himself, سبحانه يضل به كثيرا. سبحان الله. Allah said he causes people to go astray. So now إن القرآن وصف القرآن بالهداية وبالإضلال. So now the Quran is described here in the beginning of Baqarah with being guidance and described also with being misguidance. So كما أن وصف الله تعالى القرآن بأنه هدى للمتقين للمحسنين للمؤمنين. So just like Allah Ta'ala described the Quran as being guidance to the people of taqwa, to the people of ihsan, to the believers, likewise, كما فعل ذلك وصف القرآن بأنه ضلال إيمان. He said it's misguidance. He said the Quran is misguidance. For who? For who? لو أكملنا الآية سنعلم. If we finish the ayah, we're going to know. Huh? يضل به كثيرا ويهدي به كثيرا وما يضل به إلا الفاسقين. سبحان الله. Allah said he guides many to it. He misguides many to it and he guides many to it. But he doesn't misguide anyone except the fasiqin. سبحان الله. فعلى درجة الفسق الإنسان هو واقع فيه هذا درجة إضلاله. فإذا كان مؤمنا لكن يقع فيه شيء من الفسق فإذا هذا سيسبب إضلاله ولو في أعماله فقط. So if it's a believer, but he's falling in fisk, transgression and disobedience to Allah, then this is a sign of his misguidance, even if it was only in his actions. He believed in Allah, but كَانَ فَاسِقًا. But he was a disobedient individual to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَاللَّهُ تَعَالَى يُذْهِرْ ذَلِكَ عَلَيْهِ فِي أَعْمَالِهِ. So Allah ta'ala makes that this disobedience and corruption apparent in his actions. فالقرآن هدى وإضلال. هدى للمتقين المحسنين المؤمنين وإضلال للظالمين الفاسقين المعتدين وما إلى ذلك. So the Quran is a guidance for the people of taqwa, the people of ihsan, the believers, and it is a misguidance for the people of corruption, the people of oppression, and the people of transgression. Now.
جزاك الله خير.
Anyway,
I'll move the questions, inshallah. That's what you're doing. Let's see the brothers here online if they have any question, inshallah.
I was writing something down
here.
I can't see it.
And we'll see how you are. Let's see.
Yes, assalamu alaikum.
Dr. Mazen, go ahead, inshallah.
Yes, yes. Allah is khair, Sheikh Hassan. بس سريعا يعني يعني طبعا النصيحة لله ورسول المؤمنين يعني النصيحة أحيانا يعني قد إلى توابع فيعني شلون بيكون التنسيق بين أو التوازن بين النصيحة والآية الكريمة ولا تغوا بأيديكم للتهلكة ولا تغوا بأنفسكم للتهلكة بأفهم ولا تغوا بأيديكم للتهلكة نعم
نعم بأيديكم للتهلكة نعم
نعم يعني كيف يتم يعني التوافق بين من مثلا النصيحة قد تأتي يعني قد تأتي بمشاكل للشخص اللي يعطي النصيحة
نعم ما شاء الله ف الأستاذ يقول عفوا
can you repeat the question
نعم نعم he said how can we كيف نجمع بين الدين والنصيحة وبي ولا تلقوا بأيديكم إلى التهلكة. How can we harmonize between الدين والنصيحة and what was mentioned in the Dars and do not throw yourselves into destruction? Meaning that I believe that what he's indicating too is what was mentioned from either وجدنا أن الأعداد والتقاليد وهذه الأشياء تخالف ما كان عليه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فنذهر ذلك وهذا قد يكون فيه الضر. Right? That I believe. Am I correct? So I don't miss.
No, صحيح كلام سليم.
Hey, now. So yeah, so was he saying that? So now, sometimes to show the correct thing or to speak the truth could cause you harm. So what do we do in that situation? How do we go between الدين والنصيحة لله والكتابه to be sincere to the book and the sunnah and like that, and at the same time risking falling into harm? فالإمام الشاطبي سبحان الله في كتابه ما شاء الله النفيس المواثقات وهذا من أكبر الموسوعات الفقهية الموافقات right لإمام الشاطبي الأندلسي. So he إمام الشاطبي he has a موسوعة an encyclopedia of قواعد الفقهية. Very very important. This book is very very important. It's one of the biggest encyclopedias of the principles of jurisprudence. وكان مالكيا and he was a مالكي لكن كلامه النفيس ويشمل ويدخل فيه بقية المذاهب and even though he was a Maliki scholar but his statements are jewels and it fits in even to the other مذاهب فماذا قال قال ليست في الدنيا مصلحة محضة ولا مفسدة محضة ليست في الدنيا مصلحة محضة ولا مفسدة محضة. He said, there is not in the dunya anything that is a complete maslaha, a complete benefit, nor is there anything in the dunya that's a complete harm. This is nafis, ya ikhwa. Wallahi, هذه الكلمات إذا حفظناها وطبقناها على الواقع ستجد الأمور ميسرة في أكثر الأوقات. If we took this, and we implemented it, we will find the affairs, our affairs, easy most of the time. بهذه القواعد الفقهية وهي يعني عديدة لكن هي تسهل. وقبل الجواب فقط أبين الفقه والأصول والقواعد. And before I finish the answer, I just want to make a short clarity on what fiqh and what أصول الفقه is and what قواعد الفقهية is. So, أصول الفقه, the principles of fiqh, كوصفة. كالوصفة للطعام, for instance. So the principles of fiqh is like the recipe, جزاك الله خير. It's like the recipe, right? وقواعد الفقه هي كالمكونات. كالمكونات. So, and then قواعد الفقهية is like what? The ingredients. والفقه المنتج. And fiqh is the finished product. ولذلك قال العلماء إخراج الأصول على الفروع, right? That you take the أصول and then you apply them to the فروع and then that's how you get to fiqh. That's how you get to the finished answer, right? So it's a process. We, كثيرا نحن نرى النتيجة ولا نرى المعالجة. So many times we see the result, we don't see the process. هذه من طرق تطبيق المعالجة. So this is from the ways of practicing the process. فقال ليست في الدنيا مصلحة محضة ولا مفسدة محضة. He said there's nothing in the dunya that's a complete harm or complete benefit. فنظرت الشريعة إلى ما هو أرجح منهما. الله أكبر. So our legislation looks at what is more likely to happen. فإذا رجحت المصلحة شرعت. So if the مصلحة, the good that's going to happen, overrides the harm. Why? Because it could be something good that still has a certain amount of harm in it. So if the maslaha كانت راجحة, if it's more likely to happen, it becomes legislated to do. وإذا رجحت المفسدة منعت. And if the harm or the corruption that can happen because of it, if that becomes more, then it becomes impermissible to do. So now, let's practice this on واقع يعني تطبيقي. Let's now apply this to our daily lives, right? I see on YouTube, right? People are now learning and memorizing the United States Constitution. And from that, they are bringing in from the United States Constitution that يعني الناس يعني الآن يدرسون القانون الأمريكي. ومن ذلك يقولون أصلا في بان في القانون الأمريكي أن رخص القيادة ليس بلازم. ليس بلازمة. Right? They say, and in the Constitution, it says, you don't have to have, if you're a citizen of America, you don't need a driver's license. فإذا استوقفتهم الشرطة يجادلون. طيب, مجادلة الشرطة. المصلحة راجحة أو المفسدة. Arguing with the police, is the benefit of that more likely or harm? So if the police stop someone, and they want to argue with them, and they don't have a license, they want to argue. The Constitution says I don't know. So is this going to be more beneficial to the one arguing or more harmful? إذن من غير النص, we don't need an ayah or hadith. من غير النص, we say, يا أخي, قف. We say, no, brother, stop. Don't do that. Even if you have دليل في القانون, even if you have proof في القانون, why? Because لهم الغلبة. They have the authority. So even if you argue with them, you tell the judge, tell the judge, like that. إذن هذا هو الإنسان لابد كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم استفتي قلبك. So you seek the fatwa from your heart. It doesn't mean seek a fatwa from your heart in things that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم clearly spoke about, said the haram halal. But now we take the example of Bilal and Ammar. على سريع, quickly, we take the example of Bilal and Ammar. كلاهما عذب على يد القريش. Both of them were tortured by the hands of the Quraysh. أحدهما ماذا فعل؟ ظل على ما هو عليه مهما زاد التعذيب. So one of them stayed upon what he was upon. أحد أحد. No matter how much the torture was. والآخر اختار ماذا؟ أن يلفظ بما يرضيهم ما مع أن قلبه مطمئن بالإيمان. And the other one decided to say that which would please them. So they would let him go with his heart being firm upon iman, as Allah Ta'ala, حكى الله تعالى في سورة النحل. As Allah mentioned in سورة النحل, the chapter of the bee. So when Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم صوب الاثنين, and the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said both of them were right. Both of them were right. So it's up to the individual to decide. في حاله هل هذه مصلحة راجحة أو مفسحة راجحة وبذلك يعمل. And then he works or acts according to that. والله أعلى وأعلى.
جزاك الله خير. We will at the end of our session ask دعاء إن شاء الله.
نعم.
إن شاء الله.
اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا وثبت أقدامنا على الحق وانصرنا على شرور أنفسنا. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه واغفر لنا ذنوبنا إنك غفور رحيم. اللهم آمين آمين آمين.
جزاك الله خير.
آمين وإياك. الله يحفظك.
الله
أحسن. الله يحفظك. الله يحفظك. الله يحفظك.